Good morning. Today we are going to discuss presentation skills. People work hard to develop knowledge and expertise in the area of their profession. Developing the capability to present that expertise and ideas is a valuable investment. Sadly, not many make this investment. Why? Well, it is because of fear. Just the thought of speaking to public or to an audience gives us goosebumps. Human beings experience a lot of fears, but presentation skills or presentation or presenting to an audience tops the list of fears we human beings have. It is much more than the fear of snakes, heights, flying, death, etc. You could name any, but presenting to an audience tops the list. The mere thought of presenting or speaking to an audience makes our body release adrenaline and cortisol, which leads to thumping of heart. Many people experience breaking into cold sweat, yet others experience millions of butterflies fluttering in their stomach. There are others who feel their legs have turned to jelly and can't take their support. And there are some who work themselves up into a very nervous and anxious situation by frequently asking themselves, what if I forget my lines? What if I am not able to impress the audience? What if the audience doesn't like me? What if I am a failure? And the list goes on. But as they say, dar ke aage jeet hai. Let us see how we can conquer our fear and emerge as an effective presenter. The key to this thing is to define the word fear. What is fear exactly for us? Is it forget everything and run, or it is stay focused, energized, alert and ready for action? This will define whether we are going to be an average presenter who mumbles and stumbles across the presentation, or we are the cool, efficient, memorable and impressive presenter. What does a presentation do for us? It puts us on display. We are like a showpiece in a showcase for all to see and admire or turn away in scorn. It gives us a platform to showcase our talents, our skill, our capabilities to the world. It also gives us an opportunity to initiate discussions on our ideas so that we can get valuable insights from people on our own ideas. We present almost always. We present informally, simply to a small group of friendly people, over chats, over phone, selling ourselves, our ideas. Or we present complex, full-fledged PowerPoint presentations to a group of high-profile executives, again, where we are selling our ideas. So we are presenting almost always, every day, every time we face ourselves with situations where we are facing an audience and selling our ideas. What exactly is a presentation? A presentation is a tool to formally interact with people in professional or personal setting. It helps us to, as I said earlier, sell our ideas. It is a powerful, goal-oriented, interactive and audience-centered. Every time we present to audience, we need to be persuasive so that they think or do what we want them to do. In business terms, it is a formal method of bringing people together to review, monitor, plan and discuss issues and ideas. The ability to be an effective presenter is one of the most important skills we need to make ourselves successful. Let us see how we go about making this presentation on presentation skills. We have a little bit of introduction, we have modes of delivery and the four P's of presentation skills. Let us see what are the modes of delivering the content that we have. There are four most common methods of delivering. memorized speaking, manuscript reading, extemporaneous speaking, and impromptu speaking. Let us see each one of them in detail. Memorized speaking. In this, we write the speech, memorize it, and then we deliver it from memory. Each word is recited just as we had memorized it at our comfort zone. I'm sure most of us will remember our childhood days when we were asked to recite poems, tables, in school, at home, in front of the guests. Anybody would come and we would be asked to recite things. And what happened when we were doing that? Sometimes we sailed across brilliantly with flying colors. But there were times when we just forgot a word, or maybe one line was misplaced, and bam, our whole presentation was destroyed. Yes, sadly, that is the disadvantage of memorized speaking. It takes a lot of time to memorize the content that we want to deliver. Once memorized, there is always this fear that we might forget one word or a line. In short, forget the content that we have to deliver. This fear makes us very anxious and nervous. We don't come across as a confident speaker to our audience. There is another disadvantage. Once we forget something, our mind just stays stuck on that one point and our whole presentation is destroyed. Whilst we are focusing on recollecting and speaking from memory, we do not at all look at our audience. There is no connect with our audience. An audience is our cue. Audience is our customer. We have to sell our ideas to our audience. But if we are not focusing on our audience, the whole thing falls flat. Yet, there is one advantage also to this type of delivery. We say exactly what we want to say in an exact given amount of time. But this one advantage is not enough. The disadvantages outweigh the advantage for this particular type of speaking. Next in line is manuscript reading. Again, we prepare the whole content, we write it down or type it down in today's world and take it to the audience. We stand and we read word by word from our script in front of our audience, from the stage or maybe from behind the podium. This type of presenting is useful if we are presenting a technical paper or a report which has a lot of technical data or statistical data. Numbers, we can't go wrong. Whilst we are presenting, we have to give all facts to our audience. We have to be accurate. One small mistake and our presentation goes wrong. And that is why this kind of presentation style is suitable if we have, as I said earlier, a lot of technical data or statistical terms. This style again poses some disadvantages. Manuscript reading. Here, what we do is we again write out the whole content and then instead of memorizing, we just take our papers with us on the stage or behind the podium and start reading from our script. Well, this type of reading is good if we have a lot of technical information or statistical data to present, because we cannot go wrong when we are stating facts or numbers. One small teeny-weeny error and our presentation is destroyed. Our credibility is at stake when we are presenting. We cannot afford to give wrong data to our audience. So this particular type of delivering a presentation is very useful when we are maybe presenting a report or we are reading a technical paper. It has this advantage that we get to say everything that we have planned out in as we have planned. There is no scope of error because nothing is committed to memory. We are just reading from our script. But as they say, everything has two sides. So this type of delivering a presentation also has its own disadvantages. And the most important or the most significant disadvantage is that we are not connected with our audience, the audience for whom we are presenting. Because we are busy reading from a script, we lose contact with our audience. We hardly look up. We hardly see what our audience is doing. Our audience may be lost into their la-la land. Our audience may be busy snoozing. Or our audience may be busy texting on their mobile phones. We have no control over our audience in this type of presentation. It is very monotonous, very dull. It lacks spontaneity, naturalness. There is nothing intimate about this kind of presentation. There is almost no eye contact. We can make this type of presentation impressive by putting in a little effort. Whilst we are preparing our script, we also need to prepare how to deliver it. We need to take into account that whilst delivering the speech, we have to have some kind of contact with our audience, and that can be prepared. Our tone, pitch, intonation may vary. Instead of just going across as a flat rumble, we could have variation in our voice, thereby catching the attention of our audience. The next style of presenting is extemporaneous style. It is said that this particular style of presenting is the most effective style of presenting. Let us see why. In this type of presentation, everything is pre-thought and pre-planned in detail. We do write our script, we do memorize certain parts of it, we do read certain parts from our script, but we don't do in totality manuscript reading or memorized speech. All we have is the outline. That is it. It could be in the form of PowerPoint slides like I have here, or it could be in the form of a flowchart or some kind of cue cards that we carry along with us on the stage. Just the highlights are there with us, and everything else is committed to memory here. Easier said than done. This style needs a lot of preparation, lot of practice. This style also needs a lot of reading. We must be aware about our subject thoroughly. Any question that comes, we should be able to defend and answer. As I said earlier, whilst we are presenting, our credibility is at stake. If for every second question we say, "I'll come back to you a little later," we are destroyed. The audience thinks, "Boy, this chap doesn't know anything. All he or she knows is what is there on the slide or what he has prepared. Other than that, this guy knows nothing." We can't afford that. So a lot of preparation goes into it, but once prepared, this style gives us the opportunity to stay connected with our audience. Because we are not reading, because we are not focusing on our memory, we are almost always with our audience. It gives us an opportunity to look at our audience and tailor-make our presentation. For instance, if our audience is a little bored, we notice one or two people yawning or looking at their watch time and again, we may bring about some change in the delivery. We may inject a bit of humor. We may have a little bit of storytelling, or we may quickly take a break, keeping into account what we see on our audience's faces. This kind of tailor-making the presentation is available only with this extemporaneous speaking. Lot of advantages: it is spontaneous, it is natural, we are able to build rapport with our audience, we are able to make a lot of changes in the midway, as we call them mid-course corrections. We are able to do all such things with this type of presentation speaking, style of delivery. The next is impromptu speaking. Impromptu, well, we are sitting and all of a sudden somebody says, "Oh, why don't you air your views?" When we speak without preparing, all of a sudden, that is impromptu speaking. There is no particular preparation for that occasion. We have had almost no time for rehearsal. And Mark Twain once said that it takes months to prepare a minute speech of impromptu speaking. He wasn't off the mark completely. How can you speak after all if you don't know anything? Just as we need to do a lot of reading and extemporaneous speaking, impromptu speaking also requires a lot and lot of preparation. We need to be well versed with what is happening around us. We can make it more effective by listening actively to what is being said at that moment. Somebody has already said something and then we have been asked to give our views. What was it that that somebody spoke? If we listen to what they were saying, we are able to form an opinion. We are able to form some kind of thought and use that as our introductory point or our launch pad. Alertness, staying on with the speaker, is the key for impromptu speaking. These are the four methods of speaking, but sadly, it is us, the presenter, who will decide what style we need to adopt. And not just our style, not just our choice, it is also the demand of the situation or the subject that we are going to talk about. As I told you, if it is technical presentation or a paper that we are reading or a lot of statistical information that we are about to give to the audience, the subject by itself demands that we go for manuscript reading. So we need to take into account the situation, the subject, our own preparation, in fact our own personality also. I may not be one who can go for extemporaneous speaking. I don't have that kind of outgoing personality. It may take time for me to develop, but as of now I don't have. So maybe I can only take recourse to manuscript reading or memorized speaking. The trick is to evaluate the situation, the subject, keeping our personality in mind and then deciding what will be our mode of presentation. Ideally, experts of communication say presentation should be a combination of all the three, four styles that we've just talked about. I'll give you a small example. What we can do is, we could memorize a catchy opening. And then, when it comes to giving out some statistical data, we could read it from our script that we are carrying or the notes that we are carrying in the form of cue cards or note pages. And we could then speak about, as we had planned, one step after the other. Once asked a question, which may be not directly related to what we are talking about or what we have prepared, we could be in the impromptu mode of speaking. So, it is all the styles combined into one particular style of presentation. Let us now move on to the four P's of presentation skills. Well, I would say they are not just the four P's of presentation skills, but they are the four P's of success. And the experts of communication have rightly called them the four-step approach to success. There are time-tested and proven methods of achieving success, of approaching a particular problem. And they are plan, prepare, practice, and perform. No matter what the issue at hand is, if we follow this four-step approach, we are bound to be closer to success. What is plan, prepare, practice and perform? Let us see each one of them in detail. But before that, it is important to remember that the order of the four P's is very important. Especially in presentation skills, what happens is most of us actually jump to the last P directly, skipping the first three P's. And that is perform. Without any preparation, we just jump to performance. And that is where we go wrong. We need to go one step at a time and in order. We just can't take the last step first. Let us see each one of them in detail. They say that if you fail to plan, you have planned to fail a lot.
नहीं मैं तो कर लीजिए बाद में क्लियर कर
दूँगा। I just don't know. They say that if you don't plan, then you have actually decided to fail. The first step of preparing for the first step of delivering your presentation is to go into planning. The bottom rung, the first step on the ladder. Yes. Appreciate and respect your audience. Your audience has probably spent a lot of time, energy, and even money to listen to you. Respect that. Give them what they have come for. And for that, you need to plan. The basic step is that why are you making this presentation? Why are you speaking to your audience? What is the objective behind giving this presentation? If you are not clear as a presenter that why are you presenting, the chances are that your audience will never be clear. It is important to decide what is it going to be all about. And one needs to remember that no two objectives will be met by the same presentation. We may have one main objective and several subsidiary objectives, but one main objective, that is the keyword. For example, for this particular presentation, we need to see whether it is to inform our audience that we are going to talk to them, inform, give them knowledge about something, it is to persuade them to buy something, to take a particular action, it is to motivate them, inspire them for something, or we are out here just to sell our ideas, our products. Or for a teacher, to teach and share with the students what is this all about. One objective. We all need to take a call on that before we even start thinking about presentation. The next thing that we need to plan is our audience. Who is our audience? Who is going to listen to what we have to say? What is the culture, gender, demographics of our audience? Why are they here? What do they want out of it? Audience is our customer. We have to sell our ideas to our audience, and for that we need to have a basic profiling or analysis of our audience. Let us divide, maybe make an acronym out of audience. We need to first and foremost analyze our audience. Why are they here? What do they want? Who are they? How many in number would they be? Etc. etc. Move to the next step, and that is understand our audience. What is their knowledge level? What is their background? What do they want from this particular thing? Are we able to deliver that kind of content that they are looking for us? Move into demographics. What is their age? What is their gender? Marital status? The culture that they come from? The values that they bring with them? And maybe the background. Why is it important to go into the demographics? Well, let us take the example of age. If we don't know what kind of age group are we going to address, we might go wrong. For example, we have prepared our presentation for youth, but we are faced with the audience who is all maybe the older ones. Our style has a lot of activities, running around, a lot of things that appeal to the youth, which may not at all appeal to the old. They may not really appreciate running around in your class, in your presentation, in doing the activities that need a lot of movement. The old are considered to be slightly stable, more fixed in their ideas, while the youth is considered to be dynamic, ever-changing, ever-growing. These two may not match. Again, we may be asked to address maybe 10-year-olds and we talk about career in astronomical sciences. Well, it will not go well. Gender. Let us all agree. Males and females, they all think differently. There are different appeals to both of them. We need to prepare our content which is gender neutral, which appeals to both the gender of our group. We cannot be focusing only on one particular gender. I have not taken into account who my audience is, and what I do, I end up talking about feminism to an all-male group, or I end up talking anti-feminism to an all-female group. Nobody is going to listen to me. I would be treated with this kind of stare, that, oh yeah, you're going to tell us what we need to do. Well, I lost my audience right in the starting. So it is important to take into account the demographics of our audience. And then comes interests. What has brought them here to listen to you? Is it just compulsion because they are part of a group which has to mandatorily listen to you, they are already lost on you. They are already closed. What you need to do to revive their interest and make them sit up, perky, and listen to what you have to say? Or if they are there on their own, what exactly are they looking for? What is in it for me? This is a million-dollar question. Each one of us asks ourselves, for whatever we do, what is in it for me? What am I going to get out of it? We need to address this particular thing very, very carefully. E stands for environment. Where am I going to speak? What kind of environment would it be? If it is too hot, stuffy, humid, our audience will not listen to what we have to say because they are just busy wiping out the sweat of their forehead or just be fidgety. If it is too cold, too hot, the audience is lost. Environment also means where, as a presenter, am I going to stand and address the audience? Where will I place my projector? What is the kind of electricity connection that we have? Do we have a lot of fluctuations, on and off, power goes on and off, or it is a stable connection? Because it might just destroy your presentation. Everything that we have to speak is there in the form of a PowerPoint slide, but the electricity is not there. How are we going to deliver it? So we have to take care of all these things when we are planning, and that is the first step. I hope you now agree why I call it the first step, or rather the experts call it the first step. Then comes the needs. They may have several needs. They may also carry with them a lot of baggages, which may make them biased, which may restrict their reception of the ideas that we as presenters are going to give them. How are we going to address them so that the baggages don't act as baggage, as a burden? Rather, they help us in delivering our content effectively to our audience. We will have to match our needs, our aims and objectives to that of the audience. Aligning those two is the key. That will help us to achieve a bond with our audience. C, customize. Audience may have a lot of needs, a lot of things. Are we going to give all of that? How are we going to customize our presentation to suit the needs of our audience? We need to think about that beforehand. And then the last is expectations. It is very difficult to live up to the expectations of our audience, but we have to manage the expectations of not just the audience but ourselves also. Then, most of the times, one question that I am asked is, how do we know in advance about what our audience wants when we don't even know them? Yes. We need to do this kind of audience profiling beforehand. But how? Once we decide that we have to give our presentation, we need to ask around. We need to see who is going to attend. If we know them, we already start taking in our minds what all moves that kind of audience. If it is totally unknown audience, then we need to ask the managers to give us a basic profiling. We could depend entirely on them for the information, or we could be specific and ask them point by point what do we want so that we are able to make our presentation suitable to our audience and cater to the needs of our audience. Once we have done that kind of thing, then we move on to the next step, and that is for the next P, and that is preparation. Whilst we are preparing, we need to take into account certain points. The first is positive mindset. If we do not value what we are giving, our audience will not. If we do not value what we are doing, we will not put in our 100% effort also. So, in order to be a success, we need to first value the thing that we are doing. And then, we need to probably pep talk ourselves. No matter how seasoned a presenter we are, we still would have some kind of anxiety. Experts say that a little bit of nervousness or tension before presentation or before doing a particular work is good. It is creative tension. It motivates us to give our best to the audience. So we need to at times pep talk ourselves, give us just a shot of glucose that yes, I'm going to do it and I'm going to come out fine. In other words, we need to visualize success. Just before presentation, if we visualize that we are getting a standing ovation from our audience, there is nothing better than that. It keeps on working on our psyche, it keeps on working on our subconscious and helps us give the best to the audience. The next is opening. Whilst we are preparing, we need to focus on how we are going to open our presentation. They say, first impressions are the last impressions. So opening is most important. The experts say there are several ways of opening our presentation. We could have a bang, boom. Yes, it is a bang opening, but is it good? No. Our opening can be catchy by maybe using a quotation from somebody, by maybe stating shocking numbers so that the audience is jolted out of its slumber and they start paying attention to what you have to say. It could also be a story. We could narrate our personal some kind of story so that the audience is able to relate to what we are going to say. But it is important to understand that the relation should be there. At times we just narrate a story and fail to establish the relation. The audience will not make that relation and our starting will go bad. We could just have a sincere compliment for our audience. And that will be enough to make them listen to what we have to say. Whatever we do, honesty, sincerity, and fact. These are the three things that are important for our opening. Then we need to prepare about the illustrations or the graphics that we are going to use. Most of us these days use a lot of computer aids. We have PowerPoints, we have images, we have videos, we have a lot of sounds, animation to strengthen our presentation. But let us remember that the audiovisual aids are there only to support us. They are aids. They are not the presenters. At the end of the day, your success will depend upon how you have been able to deliver your content, not your aid. Aid will just support. We also need to, most importantly, focus on our structure. How is it that we are going to present the content to our audience? Is it going to be a meaty sandwich where we have a beginning, middle and end, with the middle getting the chunkiest or the fattest piece? Or is it going to be a hierarchical decomposition where we break down everything into subtopics, further subtopics till the whole thing is decomposed? What is the kind of time that we are going to devote to each part? Yes, there has to be a beginning, there has to be a logical and sequential middle, followed by a logical and sequential conclusion or end. What kind of time are you going to devote? Ideally, it is 10 minutes for your introduction, 15 minutes for your conclusion, and rest of the time for your middle, where you give out the details of your content. It has been said in several ways. Tell them what you are going to tell them, the introduction. Tell them, the middle. Tell them what you just told them is the end or the conclusion. We'll have to work on that. And last but not the least, the closing. They say that closing is as important as the beginning. People only remember what you said in the beginning and what you said at the end. So make it very, very impressive, no matter what. See that when you are closing, you restate key benefits. Time and again, we will have to tell our audience that this is what they are going to get out of this presentation. There has to be a convincing summarizing of thoughts and ideas in the end, so that the audience takes away that. And once we have done that, we need to thank our audience as well in the closing. Next comes the third P, which is practice. Our moms always say, make as many mistakes as you want during the practice sessions, because then it will ensure that there is less scope of errors whilst you are performing. Well, moms were always right and moms are always right. If we do not practice, we do not stand to gain anything. But whilst practicing, if we continue making the same mistake over and over again, it will not help us. It will only lead to doing the same thing in front of our audience again. So whilst we are practicing, it is important to practice in front of an audience before. It could be a coach, mentor, friend, guide, parents, or as technology is ruling that world, a video camera. Practice and review your visuals, review everything. Take a feedback on each and every aspect of your presentation from your coach, guide, or camera. See whether you had a memorable beginning, whether you were able to deliver the points effectively, clearly, and as per the expectations of your audience. Whether the visuals that you had in your presentation, they were clear, they were apt, and they were able to communicate exactly the message that you wanted to communicate. Take a feedback on any distracting mannerism that you had. Maybe you kept on scratching your head or your cheek, or maybe you kept on saying, okay, fine, or the voice fillers, Take a feedback on all of these things and improve upon. Most importantly, practice having confidence. If you practice confidently, you will come across as a confident presenter. After practicing comes perform. We have done the planning, we have done the preparation, we have done the practice part, and now it is the show time. Let us perform in front of the audience. And how do we do that? We need to make a first positive impression. First impression has to be positive. Easier said than done. How do we go about making a positive first impression? Well, the first step is to be well-groomed. A well-groomed person with a pleasing face, pleasant personality is almost always liked by everybody. So let us be well-groomed for our audience. Let us have poised, confident body language. Any nervous gesture that we keep on doing, it could be shaking of our hands, it could be shaking of our legs, it could be crossing and crossing of our arms, it could be hiding our hands in the pockets of our jacket or trouser, or it could be the way we stand, just about anything. We have to ensure that we come across as a very, very poised, calm, sophisticated, unruffled individual. And that we can do with our body language also. Whilst we are practicing, we have taken enough feedback on our body language. We have taken feedback on whether we have any particular distracting mannerism or mannerisms, and that helps. Then we need to ensure that we have eye contact with our audience. If we lose eye contact with our audience, the audience is lost. If you remember, we talked about manuscript style of presenting. In that, the most important disadvantage is that it does not allow the speaker to have eye contact with his audience. Yes, eyes are the most important tools of persuasion that we have along with our speech. We need to look at our audience. We need to establish that connect with our audience through eyes. At times our audience may just be about to go into the la la land. But the minute he or she realizes that our eyes are on them, we are looking at them, they are jolted back and they are start focusing on what we have to say. So use our eyes, we need to use our eyes to have a positive impression. Try and picture a situation, imagine a situation where you have a person coming to address you who is very shy, who is just peeking out of the door. Hello, am I okay? Am I in the right place? Are you those guys? And then when he or she is speaking to the ground or maybe to the roof or maybe to the wall ahead, would you like it? No. Step into the shoes of the audience and see what the audience wants and then deliver accordingly. If it is difficult for us to maintain eye contact, the trick is to look at the shoulders of the other person or maybe at the nose or maybe the point here in between. That helps us from actually having eye contact with the other person. At times it is a little unnerving and the audience can also unnerve us by their constant stares. So this trick helps us to maintain eye contact and yet not see the audience completely. Next is being relaxed. If we are relaxed, our audience is relaxed. If We are fidgety. We give the audience an opportunity to be fidgety. These are some of the ways by which we can make a positive first impression. Once we have done that, we need to build rapport with our audience. And that we can do by being ourselves. I am somebody who is shy, introvert, and who cannot voice crack jokes. I don't want to use that kind of strategy for my presentation. Because if I do, I'm going to be totally self-conscious. I'm not going to be very comfortable with what I'm doing. And the audience is very smart to perceive that level of teeny-weeny discomfort that I'm experiencing. I don't want my audience to know that I am uncomfortable or I am nervous. So why don't I be me? Fine, I can't crack jokes, but I can still have some kind of subtle humor in my speech, in my presentation that will help my audience relax. Being ourselves is the first thing that we need to do when we are trying to build rapport with our audience. Then, we need to be sincere. We need to be we, me, myself. Imposters, fakers don't last long. Another thing that we could do is, or rather that we should do is, we should say we and not you. The minute we say you are going to learn this thing out of this presentation, our audience is lost. They don't want to listen to what we have to say. But if we say, along the path, let's see what we learn, what we get from each other, that will help. The audience will say, oh, okay, they are in it with us. The presenter is not something from the outside world. The presenter is just like me, just like the other person sitting in this room. And that works. We need to talk to the audience and not at the audience. We can't look down at our audience with disdain that, oh, you lesser mortals, you don't know anything. I am the one who's been chosen to come and give you all the kind of knowledge that you need to have. If that is our attitude, the audience will reject us outrightly. They don't want us at any cost. So it is important to remember that audience is smart and that we need to talk to our audience and not at our audience. Another thing most of the presenters do is to just ramble on. Once they press the button start, they don't stop till the timer sounds timeout thing. That is where we go wrong. We need to involve our audience. The audience needs to feel that they are a part of what we are doing. Interaction. Yes, that is the key word. We need to interact with our audience more and more. The more we take them into our fold, the more they will feel that there is something in there for them. They also have put something at stake. They would want us to succeed. They would want to know more. And how we can involve our audience? We can encourage our audience to ask a lot of questions. Yes, questions. Very tricky, very scary. What if they ask a question and we are not able to answer? That's okay, we are human beings. We are liable to err. But if we have practiced, prepared well, we'll be able to field almost all kinds of questions. And if there is a question that we are unable to answer, so be it. It's okay. We can always tell them that we'll get back to them later. And if we don't do that, then we fail as a presenter. What we need to do is, we need to go back home, do the research, and get back to the person who had asked us that question and deliver what he wanted to know. That will build our credibility. That is one of the keys of success too. But that fear that we may not be able to answer does not mean that we will stop people from asking questions. Once we encourage them to ask questions, they feel that they are a part of this thing. They are much more at ease, they are much more confident, and they are with us. Okay, so we have presented, we have done everything, now what? Nothing. Pack your bags and go home and forget about presentation. All this pep talk about delivering a presentation effectively, about teaching the butterflies to form and fly in formation and not randomly in your stomach, forget it. That is just for talking sake, right? No. Wrong. Absolutely wrong. Once the presentation is over, we need to strive for continuous improvement. And so, we need to measure our success. We need to see how well did we go whilst we were presenting. What are the areas that need improvement? What is our strength? Where did we go absolutely amazing, charismatic, and where we were stumbling? Once we have identified these things, it becomes easier for us to work upon them and bring about a change in the next presentation. And we need to look forward to the next talk. That is very, very important. So guys, this is all about presentation skills. We saw how important it is to develop the capability to effectively present our expertise and ideas in front of the people. We also saw what are the various modes of delivering a presentation, and they are memorized speaking, manuscript reading, extemporaneous or outlining method of speaking, and impromptu speaking. And we saw the four basic approach to success, and that is four basic step approach to success, and that is the four P's: plan, prepare, practice, and perform. Thank you guys for patiently listening to what I have to say, and happy presenting.